I think it's time to get started. I'd like to begin by introducing Dr. Shannon Kerwin. Dr. Kerwin teaches and conducts research in the areas of organizational behavior and human resources management in sport. Specifically, Dr. Kerwin has explored the structure of sport organization boards to determine human resource management practices that contribute to and inhibit gender equity, how personal and organizational values align to enhance important organizational outcomes, and the role of conflict in the effectiveness of volunteer board of directors. Dr. Kerwin is a research affiliate with the E-Alliance Gender Inequity in Sport Research Hub and is with the Wasserman Media Group Collective Think Tank. All right, Dr. Kerwin, we'd love to hear more about your role in development of the Same Game Toolkit.
Awesome. Thank you, Kim, and thank you, Veronica, for having me. It's definitely a pleasure. So one of my roles here at Brock is to engage in research related to program evaluation. Time is standing still, but I believe it was about 2 years ago, I started to partner with Canadian Women in Sport to look at the original version of Same Game and provide an arm's length program evaluation. And so in that original version, so Danielle went through what you now see online, but in the original version, there were six steps. So looking at collecting and analyzing data, incorporating gender equity into a plan, communicating gender equity targets, creating capacity, engaging women and girls, and then evaluating. So relatively similar to what you see now in terms of what's publicly available. But the evaluation itself involved 17 clubs going through Same Game. And step by step through the process, we were there to evaluate the tools and resources, what was useful, what wasn't useful, what needed to be tweaked, how we might improve the utility of that tool across a number of different contexts. And so what we found was one of the key pieces that was missing in the original version of Same Game was this notion of visioning. So you now see that as step one, so the vision step. And that's very, very important for what we're going to talk about today. I see some of the hesitation is don't know where to start. There's so much data. The visioning step in Same Game actually provides the foundation for what and why. So what are you looking for and why do you want this particular change or movement towards equity? Because each club, each organization will be different. And so that visioning piece is important. And also from our evaluation, when you have visioning, it moves it away from one person's sort of passion project around data collection to this collective vision of what we want to do as a group. Because that working together and moving away from, we called it operating on an island, is incredibly important. So I'm happy to be here. I'm so excited to talk about ways we can look at data without being so scared of it, and to simplify some of these terms and just move forward in a place where we can use data to effectively cause change in this space. Really, really important. So thank you again for having me. And I'll turn it back.
Great. Thank you, Shannon. I love that. Data isn't scary. It's exciting. So we should all embrace it. Next up, I'd like to introduce Crystal Watson. Crystal is a volunteer board member with the Alberta Sport Development Center, or ASDC, based out of Red Deer, Alberta. She has recently had the opportunity to participate in the Canadian Women in Sport Same Game Challenge, where on behalf of ASDC, she was able to collaborate with a number of local organizations to help bring awareness to gender equity issues in sport. When not volunteering, Crystal is a college instructor and a strength and conditioning coach. She holds a BCAN and a BCom from the University of Calgary, as well as an MA in kinesiology, sport, and recreation from the University of Alberta, where her studies focused on coach education. And welcome, Crystal. We'd love it if you could share some of your experiences with the Same Game Toolkit briefly.
Awesome. Thank you for having me today. I am very excited to be here and to share my experience with the Same Game Toolkit. I've went through the process after Shannon has done her review of it. So we got to participate in the visioning exercise. So that was the first step that we went through in the Same Game Toolkit. And we went into this challenge thinking that we had a clear vision of what we wanted to work on. Specifically, we identified that we didn't have very good representation of females at a board level. So we thought we want to go in, we want to address this. And then through our visioning exercise and through gathering data from various stakeholders within our organization, we actually ended up shifting our focus of the project to look more about how can we support our community and the organizations around us to also bring their increase their awareness of gender equity and give them tools and resources to support them in embedding gender equity in their organizations as well. So it's pretty cool and definitely useful to have that visioning part and to have a clear direction on where you want to go and how you want to make an impact. And then that guided the rest of our steps in terms of collecting data, who we were asking the questions to, and what types of questions we were asking as well. So yeah, I think that's a good introduction to our project, and we had a great time with Same Game Toolkit, and we definitely recommend it to other organizations.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Crystal. And I'd like to introduce our third panelist today, Paula McKenzie. Paula has an extensive background in sport administration and has been involved in track and field for over 25 years. As a former high-performance athlete, she competed in the 2002 Olympics in women's bobsleigh. She is currently the executive director of CalTAF Athletic Association, one of the largest track and field clubs in Canada. CalTAF serves athletes from beginner to Olympic level and has the largest integrated para-athletic group in the country. She's passionate about the long-term participation of women and girls in athletics and hopes to draw upon her experience as a coach, as an athlete and a parent to make significant change in this area. She holds a Bachelor of Arts from the University of Calgary, and Paula sits on several boards and is currently the VP of Programs for Athletics Alberta. Paula, we would love to hear more about your experience in Same Game Toolkit. Over to you.
Excellent. Thank you. Hi, everybody. I'm also excited to be here. I could talk about this at length. It was such a great experience for us. How I break down the Same Game experience, I just put it into the four D's. So building on what Shannon said about the what and the why, our first order of business was discovery. So we realized that we had to do something when we expanded a program into a more ethnically diverse area of Calgary. And out of that, the recruiting for the men and boys was excellent, and we recruited zero women and girls. So right away, we knew that we needed to make some changes. We were lucky enough to be able to come on board with the Same Game crew and use the Same Game toolkit to move forward in the process of what we needed to change. The next D we call is data collection, which I no longer think is scary. But at the beginning part, for sure, it was very scary. And the Same Game toolkit really gave us some direction and showed us how to do that. And when we did hit roadblocks, because there were several, that with the cohort that we were with, we could talk to them, delve more into the Same Game toolkit and solve some of those problems. One of the great things about the data collection was at the beginning of our project, we needed to get buy-in by our leadership, not only our board, but the people with the money that could help us make real change. And I found with actually having data to back up everything that we were saying, it was just much easier to get that buy-in and then to move forward. Then we had the detailed planning and implementation stage. One of the things, just going back to the data collection, is it really did show us where to move in this process. Like Crystal said, we had some ideas about where we were going to go at the very beginning when we did do our visioning. And through our data collection process, we realized that we needed to zig and zag in a different direction. So we were able to do that. COVID as well made it a little bit more difficult to really sort of zero in on what we wanted to do. But again, using that data collection, we realized that we needed to make changes. Even in our promotional material, some of the data collection said that we needed to make changes in our uniforms, and we went to do that. And then the last D for us is down the road, what the future holds. Again, armed with this data that we have, we could see the different steps that we needed to do, and the Same Game toolkit helped us move through those steps to figure out how we make lasting change. There's some things that you can make change right away, but we really do want to look back, 5 or 10 years from now and see that this was sort of a pivotal moment in our club, in our club culture, and perhaps track and field in the province. So I'm very passionate about the data collection, and if anybody else can be part of the Same Game and use the Same Game toolkit, I highly recommend it. It was an excellent, excellent project and excellent resources. Thanks.
Great. Thank you to all the panelists for those great intros and telling us a bit about your experiences with the Same Game toolkit. So we'll jump into our discussion now, and hopefully we have some questions coming in the Q&A box as well to help guide the discussion. But just to get started, I actually wanted to start with Shannon. As a researcher, why do you think data collection is so important, and why should sport organizations care about it?
Yeah, I think both Paula and Crystal kind of alluded to this in practice, but when we're looking at data, it helps inform our decisions. So not that data doesn't lie, sometimes it certainly doesn't speak, but it shows you the picture of what you're looking at. So as human beings, we have our own biases. So if I come into even my own research projects, I'm thinking something might happen. But when I collect my data, I look and think, oh, perhaps there's something different going on. So if we take that to the practical context, it's saying, I think we might need some equitable practices in coaching. You collect your data, and in fact, it's not coaching, it's mentorship, perhaps, is a bit more specific in terms of what you're looking at. So the data helps you inform your decision making. And in my opinion, that is the best practice. If you're using data to have informed decisions, and those decisions will inevitably be more effective, particularly when you're looking for change or trying to target a group that may have been marginalized and or not even acknowledged in the past, because we do have blinders on. And so I think that's a relatively straightforward way to look at it, is just it tells us the story and helps us make those decisions.
That's great. And as you would have seen in the poll at the beginning, we noticed or had a number of different barriers that were identified. So ranging from not knowing where to start, there being too much or too little data, lack of time or capacity. What are some easy ways to get started?
The tool itself, so Same Game, gives you that visioning step, and Crystal and Paula both alluded to that as being really important. But even if you're not engaging in this very constructive, because that is it's a detailed step, visioning is really going back to what is it that you're trying to do as a club or an organization, and why do you want to do it? And then that bleeds into the question of who then do you ask for the data, or what is the context of the data? So do you have to ask your participants? Are you trying to pull policy documents? Are you looking at numbers in the community? So once you ask the what and the why, it leads into the who, and then you can start to collect data. I think going into data collection without any direction then comes into those barriers where, oh my goodness, there's so much because I'm just grabbing as much data as possible without a plan. Or it's you think there's not enough because you don't really know what you're looking for. And so it's hard to dig up. So once you have the what and the why that then leads to the who, it gives you some direction. So peeling back, that's probably the most simple way to look at those three questions, sorry. And then I will plug Same Game gives you that step. The visioning step is it outlines exactly where you should target your club, your organization's efforts.
Great, thank you. And Crystal and Paula, I'll turn it over to you now. So as people working in sport, why is data collection important to you? And do you have any other kind of reflections on what Shannon's been speaking about? And why don't we start with you, Paula? You're already unmuted.
I just feel very passionate about this and all the things that we learned through the Same Game. Data collection. I think a lot of time in sport that we sort of know what's going on anecdotally. So we can see, for instance, women and girls, we know that they leave sport in droves between that sort of 14 and 16 year old range. But when our club went and actually looked at the data, we had years where sometimes it was 43% of people leaving. And so when Shannon says it tells a story, it absolutely tells a story and just really gives you that basis or that foundation then to move forward. And you know sort of exactly what direction you need to go into.
Great. And Crystal, what about you?
I'm probably just mostly going to echo what everyone else has said because I'm right on the same page as you guys. But put like simply, if you don't ask, you don't know. Right? So you need to ask your participants, you need to ask your coaches in order to find out what's their experience like, where can you improve? Even when we have the best intentions, our actions always have unintentional consequences that we might not be aware of unless we start to ask those people. So it is so, so important. It also helps us by raising our awareness of those assumptions that we were making, challenges our views, encourages us to change direction. As soon as we're stagnant, we're no longer growing, right? So we're no longer serving the population the best of our ability. Another thing that I want to echo, I know that Paul already mentioned, is it helps to create buy-in. So buy-in from parents, athletes, coaches, athletic directors, different people in your organization, the board, to ensure that they're understanding what you're doing, why you're doing it, and maybe even to redirect you if you need to zig and zag, which often happens for sure.
Can I add on? Because I think one of the key things too is some of my colleagues do work in this capacity space. And I know one of the barriers, like we don't have enough time and resources. with data, you're then focusing your attention on the right thing. So if you're not collecting the data, you might assume, and Paul, this comes back to your point, you might assume that there's something that you should be doing. But if it's wrong, then that's such a misuse of your resources, especially if the outcome doesn't result in increased participation from girls and women, as an example. And so the data is not a surefire way, but it increases the effectiveness of targeting the right, whether it's an initiative or program or strategy. So I think that's key. We know all clubs, anyone that's on, you're working in a space where you don't have infinite resources. So where you allocate those resources becomes so much more important.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think even from my experience working at SIRC, I'd say that's a great point to bring up, that we're always worried about capacity, but at least when you can increase the chances that you're focusing on the right area and know you're doing something that's going to be beneficial, it works out really well. And I guess I was going to just ask Crystal and Paula, can you give some examples, or each of you could maybe give an example of how you've gone about collecting data? So maybe a research question or a question you've needed an answer to in your work, and how have you gone about collecting that data? And Paula, if you're ready, go ahead. Or
yeah, we struggled with this a lot about how we were going to collect the data, and because there's just so much of it, right? Back to what Shannon was saying, to just sort of focus in. So we did two things. I went back and did historical data. And so we have sort of pretty good records for about 9 years. And so I was able to go through there and you know, how many female coaches do we have? How many female board participants? Where are women and girls? What age group or whatever are they, you know, leaving the sport, that kind of thing. And that was invaluable. Like to be able to go to my board and say, hey, look, you know, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, 43% of our women and girls didn't move from our junior group to our senior group. Now we have to do something about it. There's, you know, you get complete buy-in because, you know, and the number is just staring you right in the face. The next thing we did is we put out a questionnaire, and that was a little bit more difficult just because, you know, I was making the questionnaire question and not really always knowing, you know, what to ask or how to ask it. For me was a big thing, you know, not having leading questions or that kind of thing. But we did get a lot of data from there, especially about the barriers to women in sport. We got a lot of information, yeah, from doing the questionnaire.
And just to follow up quickly before we go to Crystal, were there any resources, or like, what did you do to help figure out how to ask those questions? Was there anything that helped you? Do you have any advice for anyone else that might be in the same boat?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, being part of that same game toolkit process, but the best thing about that whole process is that we had a cohort. So we had a lot of different organizations that were going through exactly the same thing that we were going through in different stages. So we were able to bring the questions to the cohort and say, hey, what do you think about this? How should we ask this? And then there were some research articles as well that we went through about how, you know, how to not have leading questions, et cetera. It definitely it took the most time, like the visioning part and then making the questionnaire took the most time because we were trying to be really careful and make sure that, yeah, we weren't pigeonholing the data that we were trying to get. So that, yeah, the same game toolkit helps a lot. I know I keep saying.
Great. Thank you for sharing. I'll turn it over to you, Crystal. Any examples of how you collected data or what kinds of questions you were answering with that?
Yeah. Similar to Paula, because we were going through the same toolkit. We started by looking in at our own organization. So we used evaluation tools that had already been created by Canadian Women in Sport. And I can't remember the name of them, but Danielle, maybe you could pop them in the chat box for everybody. But yeah, there was one where we were looking internally at our own organization and our policies at different places and reflecting on that and seeing what kind of change we could make. But then there was another one too that Paula had mentioned that talked about like, what is the quantity, the number of female participants and male participants at each of the different age groups of athletes and the different levels within the organization as well. So the board level, coaches, officials, things like that. And then we ended up using Canadian Women's Sports survey, the questions that they had to evaluate the relationship or ratios of females and males and non-binary as well. And we ended up distributing that to local sport organizations in our community to get a realistic understanding of what gender equity was happening in our area or how aware people were of it and if they were making any intentional efforts to improve it. And then we created another survey, and this one was informed by research. So we went into the research, read different journal articles, found one that was driven by theory and that had been used on a similar population to what we were going to be using. And we modified the question slightly to ensure that they were appropriate for our population. And then we ended up surveying over 400 high school students with these questions that we found evidence-based from the research.
Okay, awesome. It's a great example. And I'm actually going to turn it over to Kim now. I know we've had a number of great questions popping into the Q&A box, so let's answer some audience questions for a few minutes.
That sounds good. Thank you, Veronica. And thanks, Shannon, Crystal, and Paula. We've got lots of great questions. And I'm going to start with a, let's start at the top, actually. Graham is asking, our gender equity subcommittee is currently working through the same game toolkit. As they've been working through this tool, they have identified that intersectionality and other genders are not necessarily part of the toolkit. There are discussions on what or how to focus on. The visioning may perhaps need to be revisited. Did anyone else experience this? Can either one of you speak to that?
Yeah, we did experience that. And sort of at a committee level, we had a lot of conversations about what to do. In the end, we sort of just kept going with the same game toolkit, knowing that if we were trying to create better gender equity and equality in the club, that that would spill over into the other genders that we had, that we could, because we were, you know, focusing on it and changing our programs, it didn't really matter what gender we were talking about.
Okay, that sounds great. Thank you, Paula. And this one, you kind of addressed a little bit earlier, Paula, also, but an anonymous attendee is asking, how do you avoid getting stuck in gathering data when you're working with large membership groups? When do you know that you have enough? Sometimes you can get stuck in this phase and not know if you have enough to decide on actions next step. How did you manage this?
Well, and I think Crystal too can talk to this point because they did a huge survey at a school. I think you had more than 400 participants, but I sort of think that there's not too much data that as long as you're organizing it properly in the background, and that's when the vision part, I think, comes in, that you sort of have a vision, the what and the why of why you're doing it, then it just seemed that the data sort of, you know, fell into place. Our first round of asking for the questionnaire, we didn't have enough data. And so we went back to our membership and did that again. So the what and the why really sort of helps organize that data in the back.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. And I've got a comment and a question. I'll start with the question first. Julie is wondering, her biggest challenge in getting was getting responses from participants. We received such a low number of respondents that it doesn't truly reflect our actual numbers. Any suggestions on how to get a higher response rate?
We used our social media channels. At the beginning, we weren't doing that. So I was sending emails, and then it finally dawned on me that if I'm, you know, younger than I am, I'm probably not reading all the emails, but if I put something out on Instagram, I'm probably reading that. So, we fixed that and started really hitting our social media channels, really hard. And then we had a lot of coach buy-in, right at the beginning. And so we, for one of our senior groups, we gave them the survey before practice and sort of fill out the survey and then you can practice. So everybody sort of, just sat down and did that, whether right or wrong. And we got a lot of data from that. And then we also too, we didn't actually have to move sort of to phase three, but our phase three was going to offer like door prizes for doing the questionnaire, which we got enough data in the end and we didn't have to go there, but that seemed like that was a pretty reasonable step.
And, you know, your point of knowing your demographic, yeah, kids don't read emails. They read, they're on social media, Snapchat, TikTok, all that kind of stuff. So you send out a cool little short video, you might get more traction and incentivizing anything you would get in a lot of people also. So thank you for that. And one comment before I turn things back over to Veronica, but Romana bringed up an excellent point. Some of the most important data to look at and collect is who is missing from the table. Essential, particularly when you look at the demographics of the community that should be served by a municipal, provincial, and even a national sport organization. Who is being excluded and why? And what changes can be implemented to address the shortcomings? So excellent questions to ask, Romana. Thank you. Over to you, Veronica.
Thanks, Kim. And before we jump back in, Shannon or Crystal, did you have anything to add? I know Paula gave a number of great responses to those questions, but just wanted to see if either of you had anything else you'd like to add to those responses.
Yeah, and Crystal, I know you unmuted, so I'll turn it to you when I'm done there at one point. But that last point is extremely important. One of the things I know in our research space is we are being overly critical of all research, but in the past, looking at the sample to say, okay, that it wasn't representative, but also who are we missing from those conversations? So such a great point. And I think it almost ties into the previous question in terms of who you're targeting and if you're not getting the response. And then it's being a bit thoughtful to say, maybe we need to use a different strategy. And that's where the community of practice comes in. I'm in my zone and I know how I'm going to target. I'm going to use emails. Nobody's responding. Okay, maybe we try 6 or 7 different strategies. The other piece is the role of the influencer. We talk about this as snowball sampling and mostly in qualitative research, but worse with quantitative is to figure out who are the influential individuals in the population that you're looking for. Because undoubtedly that's a reality that if that individual then promotes participation in the study, that it's going to snowball into more participation. So I think it's, if we don't see that we're connecting with the group or the numbers that we want, so if it's the size or really just there's only one group of individuals responding, we need to be a bit more creative. So then using some of our outlets to figure out how do we target other groups, I think that's an important step that needs to be taken for sure. Crystal, I'll stop there if you have others to add.
I think a lot of great points were raised there and mine are just very similar. We did have one group in our cohort or our community of practice that was able to tie the completion of the survey or the data collection tool to being able to renew your membership with the organization type thing. So that was kind of tied right into it. And I know I've participated in organizations that have a similar policy. You have to fill out the survey before you renew your certification or things like that. So it's definitely an option if that's part of your organization structure. The big thing that worked for us, the reason why we were able to collect so many responses is because we had a personal connection within the schools. We had a couple of teachers who were going to champion our survey tool and get it approved by the principal and get the proper parental approval as well to be able to ask those questions. And we intentionally went into schools ourselves to that last point or that last comment that was made. We didn't want to ask people who are already in sport because we're missing a large section of the population. So that's why we felt very important that we went into the schools to ask a large sample of people, those who do participate in physical activity and are very passionate about it, as well as those who aren't as passionate about it, and get the full understanding of the benefits and the barriers of physical activity for teens in our area.
Awesome. Yeah, those were all wonderful points. Thanks to all of you for sharing. Shannon, I actually wanted to go back to you before we took a break kind of for the audience questions. We were talking about some of Crystal and Paula's experiences collecting data with the toolkit. And I wondered, we primarily talked about questionnaires and kind of looking from that approach. Is there any other types of data collection you'd recommend, especially for people who might just be getting started?
Yeah, absolutely. That comes back to, we've said it a few times, the what and the why. And so it really, when you're visioning, what is it that you're trying to find in your organization? So if you're trying to outline the story, so the number of participants, the types of barriers, so that's the what, then your survey is the most appropriate. If you're trying to explain why a barrier is a barrier or what the barrier means to your participants so that you can formulate some sort of outcome or movement forward, maybe it's an initiative, focus groups and interviews actually become quite an important tool. And I always advocate for the combination. So yes, the data shows us the story. It tells us a bit about what's going on in your membership or in your board of directors or whoever you're targeting. But following up with some form of qualitative research, so an interview with a few of your participants or a focus group, it starts to answer why. So why is this the way that it is with the group? And that's where we really start to break down some of our assumptions, because we can assume a barrier is a barrier for a given population, but we don't really know why it is. If you label that, even in our initial poll, to say the barrier is that there's too much data, I can make a lot of assumptions about what that means. But until I go and ask those respondents, okay, tell me why you rated that. The why isn't really there. And then to me, the most meaningful piece is answering the why so that you can actually do something that's really effective in that space. So I would advocate for a combination of some of these methods. And then it helps. It's almost cyclical because same game's offering that this is something that shouldn't be a one-off. So data collection shouldn't just happen once and you use that data for your lifetime. This is saying, okay, we'll collect some surveys. We then answer the why with a focus group. And then maybe from there, there's another question that's asked. So the next cycle is now a survey is developed around what happened in the focus group or something additional comes out. So it definitely builds from one another and allows you to use multiple methods to really be comprehensive in terms of what you know.
Great, thank you for that. Yeah, I think thinking about it in terms of what types of questions we're asking and the best way to answer them is a really good approach. And then once an organization has all of this data, what are the next steps? Could you just start there and then I'll turn it over to Crystal.
Sure, yeah, I can. So for me, sometimes that's the most daunting piece is you're just looking at, what do I do with this? So the biggest piece at the beginning is the summary. So it actually does tell the story. Once the numbers are there, they're just numbers. But as an example on a survey, if you simply just at the bottom of an Excel sheet, what's the average score for an item on your survey? That gives you a bit of an idea. If the average score is relatively low, you start to think, well, what does that mean? And then you can move into more sophisticated items, but just summarizing what you see and then trying to paint that picture is an important first step. With interview data, it's the first step is, what are we hearing? So that's a tallying process. In the most simplest form is constantly I'm hearing that coaching is ineffective in this context, just as an example. And so, okay, that's one of our themes and 7 of our participants said it. So we're starting to dig in. So I think Crystal and Paula can probably speak to this a bit better than I can, but that simplified, just summarize, what do I see? And then you could potentially do something more sophisticated with it to look at what's related to one another. But that very descriptive piece is a key to trying to organize thoughts.
Thanks. Crystal and Paula, anything to add there? Maybe in terms of what the data you collected, like how did you look at that and learn from it? What was your next step? Paula?
I think, going back to the data that we collected that 1 year, 43% of our women and girls didn't go to the next step. So, I mean, that's sort of exactly what we did is we summarized the data. We saw that 43%, which is crazy. And then we went back through the rest of the questions to say, well, why is that? What is the thing either in track and field sport, track and field, then our club, then our specific programming and that kind of thing. And we're able to sort of track it back and through the other questions that we'd asked, for instance, one of the things that came out of there were one of the barriers were the uniform that, it was very genderized, the uniform that we had. A good portion of that 43% that 1 year just felt like they didn't want to wear that uniform. So now we can, make that change. We've added a hijab this year to our uniform, that kind of thing, but we wouldn't have really, gone into exactly what was going on until we'd summarized and saw that 43%.
Yeah, that's such great examples. And Crystal, what about you? Anything that you kind of particularly learned or like, what did you do in that? What did you find in your data and what did you do with it?
One thing that maybe I'll mention is be mindful of how you're collecting the information, right? Are you going to collect it through paper and pen version, or is it being submitted electronically? Because that's going to change how you're able to go through and analyze that information and be able to read it or not read it, right? If it gets returned or not. So definitely something to consider. We did end up going the electronic route with ours. And it was more qualitative questions that we were asking, open-ended questions. So we ended up doing more of a thematic analysis and looking for the frequency of the same themes reoccurring within the responses.
Yeah, such a great point. I didn't even think to think about that or paper versus electronic. I'm sure you get lots of scribbled responses on paper that might not be legible. But yeah, thank you for that. Kim, I know we have a few more questions coming in. Did you want to jump into some of those?
We do. And I would hate to be the person trying to read my handwriting if I had to write survey results. So yes, electronic for me is much better. There's a few great questions that have just popped in, 2 that are very similar. What happens when a club has excellent data, but you can't get overall sport data, whether it's from your provincial body or even your national body? So the club's got great data. How do you get access to the larger picture that affects your sport?
I can talk to this a little bit. We're lucky just because our PSO does keep pretty good data. But again, I think that's buy-in. And one of the things that we had to do is we sort of contacted a lot of the different clubs that are under Athletics Alberta, and I wrote a mass email that they could just send to the athletic or the executive director of Athletics Alberta saying, hey, we need this data. And, you know, sort of the more the merrier. So, you know, once we got, you know, 15 or I can't remember how many clubs that wrote that email, then they sort of had to release the data to us, which we know that they have. And so it's just sort of putting pressure on them in that way.
Excellent. Thanks for that suggestion. Crystal, Shannon, anything else to add to that before I move to the next question?
I think it's good to collect data within your own organization, within your own sport, because that's a better representation of your local reality. A lot of times when we see like big studies, then we think that it can be generalized to us, but it can't always. So something to keep in mind definitely when you're trying to get that other information, is it going to add value to you, or is the data that you have really useful and really actionable already?
Great point. Okay, one more question before I turn things back to Veronica. This one's really interesting. Any suggestions for working with collecting data from a relatively small population to ensure confidentiality? If I ask certain demographic questions, I can likely narrow it down to a few people. Any insights into that?
That's a good question. I'll start and I can let it percolate with Crystal and Paula, but I think it just depends. You can ask certain demographic questions, and I guess it's in the reporting. Are those specific demographics important to report, or are you looking at the responses as the sort of general space for the so the reporting piece? So I turn back to how we enhance confidentiality in the research that we do on campus. Is again, it comes back what needs to be reported, and then what is just part of our own understanding of the data. And so that's something that should be reconciled with the participants of whatever research you're collecting, absolutely, is to tell them upfront, what is it that we have to report? So do we have to report your age, region, club, whatever it may be? And if that's an identifier, then is that a problem? And we have to give that information. And if someone says, then I don't want to be involved, then you can't, they should not be involved. But from a research standpoint, some of that doesn't need to be reported again. It's just more as the researcher, when you're analyzing, important to know, but it's not necessarily public as you state the responses. So hopefully that is helpful to answer that question, but I appreciate that that's even a consideration, because absolutely confidentiality, particularly as we get into interview data with smaller groups, it's in some ways very easy to identify who's who. In some of those demographic variables.
Thank you, Shannon. All right, Veronica, back to you.
Great, thanks, Kim. And thanks for those great responses. Going back to a previous question, I'm wondering, we've talked about, you know, the next step being summarize the data, what can you learn with it, what can you do with it? But taking a bit of a step back, when it comes to actually looking at the data, summarizing it, do any of you have any tips for that, like mining the data for insights? So kind of like at a more practical level, what are some things that might help anyone who's new to that kind of analytical lens or analyzing their data for those insights? And anyone feel free to jump in here.
Okay, I could start, and again, I'll let some things percolate, but I do think that's the important, we're tying it all together, piece of visioning, because I've had this where sometimes you just get this enormous data set and you think, what the heck am I going to do with this? But if I come back to the purpose of my study, then that's what I'm going to do with the data. And some of it's almost like parking things. So this is what's important to our vision. What I'm looking for, these factors on my survey, these particular responses are what's really important to the purpose, the vision. And then maybe you have a separate file that this is really interesting. And these are like these numbers, these statements are, but that's not necessarily what we're focusing on now, but you don't get rid of it because it's all interesting and it's certainly useful. And so if you continually have that, and I know that this is what same game almost forces you to continually have that vision in mind, then it helps you say what's truly important to what we're trying to do as a group, as a club, and then what can potentially be even future, again, this is cyclical. So what can we do maybe the next step? But that might help because it is overwhelming sometimes to look at all the numbers as an example. Like Crystal, when you have 400 responses, you're thinking, oh my goodness, is all of this meaningful? Yes, but what's meaningful to your purpose? That those are almost two different questions that need two different answers.
Great. And Crystal or Paula, anything to add there? So anything you learned from your own experiences that might help others with their data analysis?
I think, one of the things, I mean, there was a question in the Q&A about diversity as well. And I think during this whole same game, when we're trying to do gender equity, that diversity piece and inclusion piece would pop in all the time. And even in the data set that we had, we were looking at it through a gender equity and equality lens, but that diversity and inclusion piece was always in there. And one of the things that the same game did was that it did force us to focus on what and why we were doing all these things, but still gave us the data on the diversity piece there that we will move on and do things on once we're sort of satisfied with what we're doing sort of with the gender equity and piece, which we think will spill over. But it was interesting how that the data set that we got sort of had those two pieces sort of woven in.
Awesome. Crystal, anything to add?
I would just say lean on your community, right? We have different organizations in our community. We have researchers in our community. We have students in our community. We even have athletes. And this is a great opportunity to help show athletes how they can transition through the sports system, how there's still room for them to participate in sport, even if they're not athletes, but there's other ways that they can go as well. So yeah, just reach out to the resource that you have around you and get more people to buy into the projects that you're doing and ask for help.
Great. And do you have any suggestions for anyone in terms of, you know, how to reach out to maybe a researcher or like how to start those partnerships? Because I'm sure it might be a bit intimidating maybe if you don't have the connections to the academic community. So I don't know, Crystal, did you have any, or Book Shannon, you can answer too.
No, I'll let Crystal and I'll jump in after Crystal.
Yeah.
I just send them an email. I've read some of their work. I send them an email and say, hey, what's happening? Do you want to sit down for a chat? And yeah, we just have a little discussion and see where it goes. And if they can't help you, then you just ask, do you know someone else who might be able to help me or point me in the right direction or give me the information that I need? And yeah, like our sport community is so supportive. So you'll definitely find, and the academic community is also very supportive. So you'll definitely be pointed in the right direction if you're not there already.
That's great to hear. And Shannon, did you have anything?
From the two lenses. So in the project, when we were evaluating same game, just that community of practice between the clubs was phenomenal in terms of them leaning on each other and sharing resources. And we did end up using that term community practice a lot. And some of them said that they went outside of their particular sport and just looked at other sports in their community and what they were doing. And I think that was really important. And then jumping back to the point of us in an academic community on campus, constantly looking for experiential education pieces for our students. So that's something to consider as well. As a faculty member, absolutely, we're happy to at least guide you. If I don't have the expertise to help you, I can certainly connect. Similar to the sport industry, the sport management research community is somewhat close and we all pretty well know each other for the most part. And so we can connect you. Or as I say, here at Brock, we have a large undergraduate population where our students are required to engage in research in their third and fourth years. And those are places where they would be supervised by a researcher, but it's also a place for learning and development for them. So a really good connection. So the point, don't be shy to reach out. Those are places where you certainly can send an email and see where that lands. But yeah, community of practice from both the sport community and then the sport research community.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And Kim, is there any other questions coming into the chat box that you'd like to pop in now? Because we're getting close to the end of the hour.
No, but I did want to jump in and just say, if you're looking for some connections with researchers, reach out to SIRC. We have, as you know, we are the network maker in the sports sector, and we know a lot of researchers work on different projects. So if you don't know who to email, because Crystal, I agree, if you don't ask, you don't get, so send that email. But if you don't know exactly where to reach out to, send us an email and we'll certainly help you get connected to the right people who are doing work in the area you're looking for.
Awesome. Thanks, Kim. Definitely echo that point. SIRC's here to help. And yeah, I guess just to finish off with the last couple of questions, we've talked a bit about, you know, how we've summarized and used the data, but what do you think are some ways to leverage the data that we collect in sport? So as a sport organization, how have you leveraged some of that data? Or even Shannon, like what are your insights as a researcher? And I think we haven't heard from Paula in a while. Do we want to start with Paula?
I think one of the biggest thing, you know, we're we're all looking for funding, always. And I one of the things I've learned through grant writing is that you really do need to tell the story, not only about the emotional part of it, but, you know, the what and the why. Again, I know we've talked about that a lot, but the data that we've collected during this process has really helped us fill out the story for these grants and the funding that we're getting. You know, again, going back to that 43% of girls and women, you know, dropping out. Now you can put that into a story saying, hey, we knew this was happening. We collect the data. It actually is 43%. And here's the things that we want to do. And here's how much money that's going to cost to be able to do it. Yeah, it creates the buy-in and loosens the purse strings, I think, a little bit.
Well, that's a great suggestion. Crystal or Shannon, any other ways that you would leverage data or any other things you can think of?
Nothing beyond Paula, I sort of hit it there, because when we think from my perspective here, we're looking at grant writing, and then also in the community, you're looking at grant writing, and a large portion of the grant is to provide data to show the need or to justify what is happening within the grant, whatever the grant is. So there's so many different partnership grants, you're looking at initiatives, whatever it may be, but you need the data in order to justify the need. So leveraging is a key piece. And so I continue, I'm like a broken record coming back to the vision, but this is where we say, why do you need this particular data? Why do you need the change that you need? And your stakeholders should be involved in that visioning process. So again, I come back to, it's not just two people in your organization. 100% we need champions for change, but you need buy-in too. And to get that buy-in, the visioning step should include your stakeholders. And therefore, the leveraging piece almost works itself out, because they've been involved in that process, whoever it may be, your board of directors, it could be your sponsors, it could be your community partners, whoever it is, your facilities, but they're involved in that process. And so if they understand the what and the why, then leveraging the results is almost an inevitable, because they've been on board the whole time.
Awesome. That's great. And Crystal, anything on your end?
And I guess at the end of the day too, like making change within your own organization. So yes, helps us get more funding so we can do more great things, but also make sure that you're making those changes and you're going to attract more attention. You're going to ensure that you're serving the population to the best of your abilities as well. So that's a big value of collecting the data for sure.
Okay, awesome. And just to wrap up here, I have kind of one short, quick question for everyone. And that's based on everything we've discussed today, if you had one piece of advice you could leave our audience with, whether it's about collecting data, learning from it, leveraging it, what would that piece of advice be? So one key takeaway from each of you. And I'll start with Shannon, since we started off with you today. Sorry, putting you on the spot.
That's okay. I just say embrace the why. Why do you want the data? What is it that you want to do as an organization? That becomes the key piece. I know even on some of the stuff that I've worked on here at the university, if I'm functioning on an island by myself, sure, I have all the best intention, but I'm not necessarily targeting, why do we need this? Why? What is going on in our organization, in our university, in our student, whatever it might be? And so, yeah, embrace your why. What is it that you're doing? And then that will help guide everything else.
Fantastic. Crystal, why don't we go to you next?
I would say go in with an open mind, like not with predetermined expectations or with an idea of what you're going to find, but just nice open mind and be open to continue to explore and discover new things that you would have never considered otherwise.
Awesome. And last but not least, I'll turn it over to you, Paula.
I would say scary, not scary, right? So at the beginning of the process, yeah, there's a little bit of fear there and there's a steep learning curve. But once you get into that and you can see what the data collection can provide, buy-in, all the things that we've talked about, that fear just sort of dissipates and then it's not scary.
Awesome. And Kim, yeah, I'll turn it over to you now that we've got all our key takeaways, our advice summed up. Turn it over to you to, if there's any final questions or to wrap up the webinar.
I'm just going to wrap up. I'm going to say, I think we heard that you need to have an open mind. You need to ask why you're collecting the data and what you're going to do with it, as well as it's not scary. Data is not scary. I love that. Data is not scary. And if you want some more information on how to collect data, please have a look at SIRC's Mastering the Art of Evaluation series. It's on our webpage. Also, go check the Canadian Women in Sport website, find out more about the Same Game project. So with that, I'm just going to say thank you. Thank you to Crystal. Thank you to Paula and Shannon. Thank you to my co-host, Veronica. And thank you to all of you for joining us today. I think Mezzi's just sharing now the next two webinars in the series. So please stay tuned for registration information coming out early in the new year. And I'd like to wish everybody happy holidays. It's snowing in Ottawa. It's beautiful. I hope you enjoy the rest of your afternoon. And thanks again for joining us. Un grand merci tout le monde. And also a big thank you to Sport Canada for financially supporting this series as much as they have been. So thank you to all and happy holidays.